Okay, I think that's 10 o'clock. I'm just sorry to interrupt the view. Alright, let me just hide the chat. Oh, there we go. I've got my little, it's a blackbird. I've got a special guest here with me today. That's Ronnie Barker. Ronnie, you can look at the camera. You don't know what a camera is, do you? You're not going to look at the camera, no. Anyway, that's Ronnie Barker. He's sat with me today. So, greetings and welcome. My name is Jake Rayson. I am a forest gardener and a forest garden designer, and I am speaking to you today from the Tavy Valley between Llandidoch and Poppit Sands, St Dogmore's and Poppit Sands in Crikey, I don't know, is it on the board? Must be Pembrokeshire. Yeah, it is Pembrokeshire. It's right on the border between Pembrokeshire and Ceredigion. And I am talking today about the 1,000-acre forest garden. And it's, I'm working at the moment. I'm kind of doing gardening, hence why I'm here and not speaking from my office with a slideshow. I'm speaking from some old-fashioned notes. And yeah, it's one of those relatively unscripted events, but I do have quite a lot of things to say. The idea for a 1,000-acre forest garden really comes from the kind of sense of a lack of change, but I do think we have to be careful about where we get our senses from. If you listen, listen to Radio 4 in the morning for news, and it really is the BBC really is a propaganda channel for the government, and it doesn't offer any kind of critical analysis or any kind of challenging questioning, in my humble opinion. And there's very much an orthodoxy in the views, in economic and the political views on the BBC, and people are not taking the climate and ecological emergency seriously. I think it's important to focus on the climate and ecological emergency. It is not going away, it is getting worse. Ben C, who's Climate Ben on Twitter, he was looking at research. He's great because he references all the stuff that he tweets. He references it. He's got links to the research. So it's not like you say, 3.5 degrees Celsius possible by 2050, only 30 years away, 3.5 degrees Celsius temperature rise. That is catastrophic. We're right, I think, on the cusp of, or just tipping over, 1.5 degrees Celsius temperature rise. 3.5 degrees Celsius is kind of like, it's wiping out loads of things. Like human existence is kind of up there. It's on the line, and people aren't talking about it in the mainstream media. So I think it's important that we do talk about it and start to challenge it and do what we can. The last part of this is connecting the dots. I think there's a real, if you look at the history of, kind of economic systems, capitalism, whatever you want to call it, but there is an increasing specialisation. So, for example, on site here, there's an electrician down by the house who's doing the electrics, wiring up the electrics for the patio. There's builders doing the rendering on the outside. I'm the gardener, I'm doing the planting. So, there's a delivery person. There's lots of different kind of trades, and there's lots of specializations in this. And what happens is people become very good at doing one thing, but it loses connection with what other people are doing, but also a connection with the worth of that work and whether the work that you're doing in a grand scheme of things is good work or not. And there's good work in terms of a very narrow definition of the work. Does it do that very specific job? But also how that work fits into the grand scheme of things. So, for example, carbon footprint of building is massive. There's a lot of concrete used in a lot of building, so concrete freeze box used all over the place, and concrete in the reinforced concrete as well. So the carbon footprint is huge, ecological damage is huge because of the amount of greenhouse gases which are produced in the creation of concrete and cement. And that's not taken into account. So you've got to link the things together. But everything that you do, does it fit? Is it contributing? Is it helping? And it's useful to look at this in terms of, so start, the base point is climate and ecological emergency. And that's the base point to look at it from. And then does it fit into that? So I just heard on the news today, I'm talking about the ecological emergency, Woodland Trust, there's a report they've created, was quoted on the news. So only 7% of native woodland in the UK is in a good state, only 7%. And it's that there needs to be quadrupling, I think, of the planting of native woodland and more money put into it, etc., etc. And it's just treated as one single item, 30 seconds on the radio. That's the only mention on the entire show. So yeah, we need to link these things together. They are related. So it's all very well doing forest gardens, and I think it's great, I think it's a fantastic way thing to do, but it's positioning in that and thinking about that forest garden in the wider landscape, quite literally in the wider landscape. So the other thing I was going to quickly mention as well, quick name check for the Roots and All podcast. And I got the idea. I mean, it's not a new idea, but I got the idea for a 1,000-acre forest garden for each and every town in the UK to have. I got that idea from the Roots and All podcast, and they had an episode on the Tocachi Millennium Forest. So I put this in the show notes, and it was Dan Pearson and Midori Shintani, and yeah, it's. They've got a 1,000-acre kind of woodland garden in Japan. So that's a really interesting project. And I thought, why not a 1,000-acre forest garden associated with every town? So rather than acres of pasture, I'll just show you. You know, we look around. Just look around. And you'll see, where's my pen? My pen there. Oh, there it is, pen. Pointy thing. That way, lot all the way along here. This is all pasture. There's cardigan over there as well. But pasture is animal agriculture is very carbon intensive. So there are three things that you can do immediately straight away. Number one is go vegan. I use the V word. Go vegan. Plant-based diet. Call it what you want. Don't eat things, stop killing things, stop eating wildlife, don't eat fish, don't eat dairy. I mean, I'm not, this is where we're heading as a kind of family, but this is the single biggest impact that you can make in your carbon footprint is to change your diet, to change your lifestyle, is to go vegan. I'll just say that, number one. Number two, don't fly, stop flying. No, don't fly, you've got pretty much no need to fly anywhere. Yeah, and it's obviously it's not the same for everybody, and some people can excuse it, but don't fly. Don't fly, stop flying. And then the third one is to get involved, get politically active, politically with a lowercase p, get involved. And what I'm really aware of now is the shortening time frame. So we've only got, for example, today, drive down the road, there's a slurry tank and there is a smell of cow shit all over the fields, which they put on the fields to encourage the grass to grow, and nothing else can compete with this, you know, slurry drenched nitrogen rich pasture. They grow the grass, harvest it, turn it to silage mostly, and then they use it to feed the cattle in sheds and in kind of cow factories, and that's generally that's the dairy industry, and it's very intensive. It kind of reduces the amount of wildlife, it's very intensive. The whole point is to get as much grass as possible, like one or two species of grass, and that's just very, really bad for wildlife and very bad for diversity. So that's the first thing. Secondly, it's all the equipment that you use. There's a nitrogen fertilizer, which is incredibly energy intensive to create and creates a lot of greenhouse gases, but it's the cheapest way of getting the bulk of grass as, you know, as a product, as an industrial agricultural product. And then there's all the equipment that you need to do it. So you need tractors, I saw massive, great, those great big 10-foot wheels, tires rather, all made out of oil, out of rubber, and there was like four of them on the back of a truck. And you go, that's constant. And we can't keep on doing this. There has to be a better way of creating agriculture, of growing stuff. So what I'd like to see, and I don't know, you know, you've got to start somewhere, but is a move toward agroforestry, which is essentially it's forest gardening at scale, forest gardening for a kind of commercial, on a commercial level. I'm not, it could get into the whole, the kind of politics of, and the economics of the agricultural system, but I don't really want to, but I think that we need to reduce the footprint of agriculture. So go vegan, get behind agroforestry. Just imagine how much, I mean, just look, these are perfect conditions here for hazel orchards. Just imagine how much you could grow. I've got to get the dog down. Ronnie! Oh dear. Right, you stay there. Sorry, dog's kicking off. So, the 1,000-acre forest garden, the idea behind this is to actually get movement on it. Present it, I mean, there's a thing in permaculture called stacking functions, where you have one thing will do more than one... something will have more than one function, will have more than one use. So with a 1,000-acre forest garden, if you actually get the trees in the ground, I think work with wildlife organisations and set it up in combination with. So what you're actually doing is setting up a wildlife reserve, but with productive edible crops.
Yeah.
So that's the kind of angle. First of all, get the trees in the ground. Sweet chestnuts, hazelnuts, get them in the ground, get them growing. In 30 years time, when I will be 80 something, then the trees will be producing. And it could make all the difference to a load of people, I hate to say it. At the moment, everything, all the economic system is globalized, and agriculture is commodified, and it's just easy to buy stuff from the other side of the world because it's cheap, with no regards to the environmental effects of it. But actually we need to look at the future and how we can change that. So along the way, I think if you actually get started with a plan to plant up the to figure out how to start the site and say this will be a wildlife forest garden and it's for the wildlife and it's for diversity, but the other functions as well. So you can have allotments. There is a great demand for allotments, so somewhere near, it has to be near the town itself, and then as a park too. So the use of green space, I mean, this has been absolutely massive in during the pandemic. The access to green space, the richer you are, the more access to green space that you have. The more access to green space that you have, the better it is. It is a matter of life and death. But if you have somewhere where you can meet people and it's outside and it's you're not confined into a multiple occupancy house, then your chances of catching COVID are reduced, and a whole range of other health benefits as well, obviously. So there's a park allotment, and it's a kind of community hub as well. So there's a project I'm involved in, an eco home development over in Boncath, and I am trying to get them to get both the residents and the developer and the council and the housing association. So that's gonna be really easy, organizing all those four different groups of people, but get them to, there we go. We've got people. Oh, this is the people who own the land. get them to get these people to talk to each other, and then set up a forest garden and actually kind of work on the forest garden, but as a community. So if people are working on it who are the residents, then it's going to be less. Do you want to come up?
No, it's all right.
Yeah, okay. Oh, shush. Right. Bonnie, shush. He gets a bit of height on him. Bonnie. Shush. Excuse me one second. Bonnie. Shush. Stop. Sorry about that. Stop. Anyway, where was I? It's all going on. Don't work with animals. I shouldn't have brought him out, but there we go. Stop. Boncath, the development, yep, so it's getting groups of people to work together, and the whole idea is that the residents are the people who do the maintenance, and the residents are involved in maintaining the maintenance of the garden, which is the kind of critical thing. There does need to be funding for it. I do think that people, the whole idea of management and maintenance is kind of forgotten in gardens, that it's like, oh, we plant a garden and then that's it, you just let it do its thing. No, you need to have people maintain it, but you need to have people have the resources to do it. Most people can't afford to garden, particularly in the kind of economic system that we have at the moment, where an awful lot of people are working, you know, a vast number of people are working all the time, are working like 12, 14 hour days, and they're still claiming universal credit. And so to expect people in that position to be able to look after a garden as well and their children, and it's just not going to happen. So there needs to be a kind of radical rethink on a structural scale, but start off with local, on a local basis. And the question really is, one of the kind of really, really big questions about about a 1,000-acre forest garden is it a good idea? And I really don't know. I mean, I haven't started, I've just been thinking about it. But this, do you work on it? Is it much better to work on a small scale and then say, this is a model that individual community gardens can use, and then roll that out? For example, on the National Forest Gardening Scheme, which I'll put in the show notes, there's a forum, and they were saying on the forum, somebody's saying the community, people setting up a community forest garden, and they said it's been really difficult to get the information, and it's actually an awful lot of work to set it up. So it's like, do you want to set up a service where people can find the information and to set up a community forest garden and have lots of people doing that? Do you want to, but is it worth, is there any value in saying we want 1,000-acre forest garden, and that'll be that field, just as by way of example, and this is that whole side of the valley will be chestnut and hazel trees. Is there any kind of worth in doing that, or should it be like on a community basis, or should it be a mixture of both? I just think there is, if it's taken seriously as a kind of project, if you can get the money for it to set up the infrastructure, it's relatively not that much money, with a massive positive environmental impact and a kind of and an agricultural impact as well in terms of growing food. And you just think about the sums of money that are flowing around at the moment for the non-functioning test and trace system in the UK, £27 billion over 2 years. How many forest gardens could that pay for? The mind boggles. It really, really does boggle. But I think we need to kind of, it's just look at the question and say, setting up the infrastructure for this now, how do you do it? Where do you get the funding from? Where do you start with it? These are just kind of ideas. I haven't done it. I don't have a 1,000-acre forest garden. I'm not really on the process, but it's really a very important question to ask now, because it will have a major impact on a massive scale. And if you can, if one person, one person, or one group of people, one area, there'll be one garden that can be doing this, then that will act as a model for other people. And with the eco homes development that I've been working on, the biggest thing, it's really simple. It's like fruit trees with ground cover underneath, and an occasional incidental plant, a couple of climbers, and fruit bushes as hedges. Right, that is pretty much what it is. It's kind of real basic forest garden. But the feedback has been incredible. The positivity off of people saying, wow, you can eat all this. And it's been, yeah, and why not? You know, why not? So, yeah, we need, is it a thing worth pursuing? Is this kind of idea, project of a 1,000 acre forest garden, is that an idea worth pursuing? I kind of think it is. I think it is something that you need to be kind of serious about it. There is a chap in Cardiff who, I can't remember his name, who did write to me. I wrote back to him and he never replied. And, no, I can't remember his name, got a double barrel surname. Can't remember his name, but he is setting up. He has plans to set up a massive, great big forest garden, series of forest gardens near Cardiff. And you think, well, fair play. Whatever the setup he has, the actual idea behind it, I think, is commendable. And I think this is what we have to do. We actually have to say, this is the intent. This is what we're going to do. We're going to have a 1,000 acre forest garden. This will act as a model, and it will be a model for the rest of the UK. And this is how you do it, and this is how much it costs, and here's a whole lot of information about it. And this is it's a 30-year plan. It's not like we'll do it in a couple of years. This is like long term. So related to that, where am I? Oh, crikey. So related to that, I wanted to just mention another project that I've been working on, which is up in mid Wales. And I had a look at some land for a family in New Zealand. And this was really interesting, actually. Very exposed, quite thin soil, and it's a lot of work. And I was saying to him, use the lower 1 acre, it's big space as well. I think it's two fields combined, which is about, I don't know, it's about, it's a lot. It's something like 20, 30 acres or something. It's a lot. Plus, I just want you just for a forest garden, just 1 acre at the bottom of the flattest land near the surfaces, near the road. And then for the rest of the land, use native woodland, set up as native woodland. What I did do was find, I've been talking to a chap, David Hunter, who works at the Coppicewood College. They do a lot of coppicing and greenwood carpentry. A really interesting guy, met him a couple of times, and I was kind of talking to him about coppicing and, you know, the kind of values of coppicing for creating habitat and also creating materials. And I was just thinking, combining that with garden design, it would be quite incredible to actually have a designed space. I mean, like a lot of coppice, I imagine, would be designed, because you need to look at how you're going to get to the material and where you're going to get the transport in to move the material around. But if you have a native woodland which is designed, so kind of next to a house, so it's like an ornamental but functional, it's a forest garden essentially, but you're just kind of moving the boundaries away from the edible side to a different thing that you're harvesting. So I think it's the same, you know, the same ideas come in on this scale of a 1,000 acre forest garden, is that you start to design it in kind of in concentric circles, so that you have another permaculture term, zoning, so you have the different functions for different areas, so that it can be like wildlife, a managed space but it's for wildlife, or a managed space and it's for wildlife and it's also for coppicing, or for nut production, or for, yeah, or for people to walk around, or, yeah, there's a whole range of things, and they can interweave as well. So that's very exciting as well. I think the idea of a design space where you're maximizing the different functions, so the wildlife function, so you're getting the habitat. So there we go, that's me pretty much. Yeah, is there anything else I wanted to mention? Not really. But I do think it's important to get the money behind it and actually say, this is how it works, this is what it will do. I've got quite a few other things going on as well, so yeah, I'm not sure this will bubble under the surface. But if you are interested, do email me, Jake at forestgarden.wales, or hello@forestgarden.wales. And my other kind of interests really are in the kind of ecological side, in terms of forest garden, is overlap between ornamental forest gardening and ornamental gardening, edible gardening, and wildlife gardening, and the use of native plants in that kind of process. So I'm working on a project at the moment which is called Garden Wild, and it's to encourage the use of UK native wildflowers in ornamental horticulture. But that crosses over, massive crossover with forest gardening as well, and wildlife gardening. So it's kind of very, very exciting, and it's all related. There we go. There shall be a Zoom meeting. I'll go say formally thank you very much for watching. I hope that's interesting. Do get in touch if you have any ideas or views or would like to discuss it further, and see you again next Wednesday. And now I'm just going to quickly have a look at the chat, because that's a good place to do that. So Julie says, better place, I prefer to contribute financially, employ people to manage it. Absolutely. I think this is a real major thing, is to do it properly. You've got to put the money, you have to put the money up there. Not to say you can't have people. Yeah, it's a very fine balance, I think, where money's involved. Like, it's getting people to volunteer and getting people involved in it, but also getting people to do it. So to do it, like, get money for it, because not everyone can afford to do it. It's a very fine balance. I used to work, like, I did a bit of work at a art cinema in Bristol, and they always had that it was all volunteer run, and they were talking about paying some people who are doing most of the work. And it's always that thing with a community project. Do you get paid? Who gets paid? How much do they get paid? Why don't other people get paid? There we go. And cool, lovely. Okay. All right then. There we go. So I'm going to pop over to Zoom. Can someone chuck the Zoom link into chat? Because I haven't got it, and I'm incapable of doing such things. And I'm going to start Zoom up. Grab a cup of tea, and I shall see you over in Zoom. Thank you. Oh, here you go. Let's go out on the view.